wait. The webinar will start shortly. Please wait. The webinar will start shortly.
सगळ्यांची नावं का चुकी येऊन राहिली.
गुड इव्हनिंग अनिल साहेब, आय एम देअर.
येस येस,
आय एम हिअर. ओके, आय हॅव स्विच ऑफ माय व्हिडिओ ऑन म्यूट. व्हेनेव्हर यू वॉन्ट आय एम हिअर.
येस येस येस. ओके चेतन,
थँक्स
चेतन. नेम्स ऑफ द पॅनलिस्ट आर कमिंग रॉंग.
Please wait. The webinar will start shortly. Please wait. The webinar will start shortly.
Hello. Yes.
Chetan. Chetan.
Yes, sir.
बलराम यादव जींच्या ना तिथं माझं नाव येत आहे ते चेंज करा
बलराम
सर दिक्राम सर रिनेम बट तरी व्हिडिओ ऑन केलं मला चेंज करता येईल इफ दे इवन दे कॅन रिनेम इट
ही इज ऑन द व्हिडिओ ना हिज व्हिडिओ इज ऑन नाउ इट इज कमिंग करेक्ट बलराम यादव यस यस नाउ इट इज कमिंग
दिक्राम
एंड आनंद सर आल्सो इज कमिंग एज बीएस राणा सो दैट आल्सो यू प्लीज करेक्ट बलराम जी थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग
माय प्लेजर डॉक्टर नमस्कार
नमस्कार गुड टू सी यू
हाय ओपी हाउ आर यू
आई एम सर्वाइविंग सर
दाढ़ी वाड़ी बना ली है समीर जी का भी नाम चेंज करो समीर अग्रवाल नेम इज आल्सो कमिंग एज बीएस राणा
Hello, Doctor Sir.
How are you? I'm looking at you. Everything is fine at Pune.
Mathura is looking handsome. Everybody is looking handsome.
No, nowadays,
good
lot of problem is there because of Kum.
Good to see all stalwarts after long time together.
Huh? How are you, bhai?
Or kaise ho?
All good.
आप सब मोहल्ले वाले ऑनलाइन मिल रहे हैं सेम सिटी
हाउ आर यू सुरेश जी
आई एम डूइंग गुड हाउ आर यू
यू आर लुकिंग प्रीटी हैंडसम एंड
थैंक यू थैंक यू
उसने वजन कितना कम किया देखा क्या ओपी
आई नो सुरेश इज लुकिंग प्रीटी हैंडसम एंड फिट
एंड लुक एट हिम हाउ मच साइक्लिंग इज डूइंग Multiple of hundreds.
Yes. More egg, more chicken.
Power of protein.
Yes.
Balram sir, namaskar.
Namaskar, namaskar.
Namaskar, Balram. Hi, Balram.
Hi. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Shukla ji, I think 4 o'clock ho gaya. We can start. I think.
So, please.
Second. We have 311 people.
Wow.
So I think yes, that's sir. Good strength to start.
Yes, sir.
It's still increasing exponentially.
Good.
Yeah, please. Kumal sahab, we can start?
Yeah. Hi, Samir.
How are you?
Good.
All good.
गणेश वंदना वगैरह करना था ना स्टार्टिंग का हरीश
यस
गणेश वंदना करना था ना
यस
तो आज चेतन टू स्टार्ट नो
स्टार्टिंग इट
Shall I start now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, namaskar and good afternoon. Namaste to all the delegates of the webinar, all my friends and colleagues from the industry. I am very happy to welcome you all for this webinar organized by Poultry India Knowledge Day. I welcome speakers of today's presentation, Mr. Harish Tibrewal, Mr. Hemendra Mathur, and our industry person, Mr. Naren. He will join shortly. Warm welcome to all our EAC members. We are grateful for their guidance and support. EAC is the Executive Advisory Committee, which consists of all major poultry associations in India and the key stakeholders from the Indian poultry industry. These prominent and important decision makers keeps us and advising and guiding us in the interest of Indian poultry industry. This pandemic has taught us many things. The marketing models are changing. We need to keep in pace with this changing scenario in the world and adapting new models in marketing and also in poultry operations. Indian poultry sector must keep on modernizing and upgrading the technology changes. And at the same time, this digital model should also be such that it also helps the farmers to increase their income and drive us towards growth. Growth in Indian poultry industry will bring smile to all of us, all the stakeholders in the industry. Our consumers of poultry products are getting aware about the human poultry consumption, human poultry requirements, and they are getting digital. Majority of the persons are having smartphones, and we must understand the importance of digital marketing. This digital marketing model will teach us many things and support us in our business. Today's topic is in digital marketing. This is need of the hour. Today we have digital marketing experts to enlighten us towards this new way of marketing. And also our industry friend, Mr. Naren, will share his experience about the digital marketing. Thank you all for joining us. And I request Dr. P.K. Shukla to introduce the speakers and start the sessions today. Over to Dr. Shukla.
Thank you very much, Anilji. Indeed, it's a matter of great pleasure again to meet today. And on behalf of Knowledge Day organizing team, myself, along with my team members, Mr. Harish Garware, Dr. Vijay Makhija, Dr. Dinesh Mosle, Mr. Milind Limay, Dr. P.S. Mahesh, Rajesh Roshia, and Dr. Manjunath, I welcome all the participants who have joined in for this online webinar today. Indeed, I am really thankful to Poultry India and also to the EAC for enabling us to keep on going even during these odd COVID hours. Knowledge Day attracts some of the finest minds who speak on science of poultry and latest innovations in the field of breeding, hygiene, nutrition, animal health, poultry equipment, logistics, and marketing. Delegates comprising of poultry farmers, farm managers, poultry health and hygiene, and feed associates from across the country and beyond those attends this evening. Today's webinar is a part of Knowledge Day online webinar series, which we initiated in November 2020. COVID-19 pandemic situation is still here and is impacting the ways which we work. One of the significant changes COVID-19 has brought in our lives is how we can connect to each other. Digital technologies have played significant roles in our lives. We can e-meet you by virtue of digital technologies and organizing webinar. The theme for today's webinar is very apt, harnessing the power of digital applications for poultry.
Today's webinar is a part of Knowledge Day online webinar series.
And today, we have with us the following distinguished speakers, Mr. Harish Tibrewala, who shall be sharing his insights on future of digital and share with us various possibilities that digital marketing can offer to us. His presentation will be showcasing broadly the tools and tactics of leveraging digital economy. We have another eminent speaker with us, Mr. Hemant Mathur, who shall be sharing his insights on digitalizing poultry supply chain. He'll be sharing involvement of agri-tech in India, key success factors in Indian agriculture tech, and potential role of poultry associations. We have another eminent speaker with us who has shown a different kind of success story. He is Mr. Naresh. His vision to adopt sustainable production of animal protein has made the Nandu's pioneer in this category. It is the first Indian poultry company to invest in biogas-based electricity generation as well as solar-powered electricity generation to power our production process. So what we have thought of while designing today's webinar, let us have a view of Harish ji overall, how this digitalization can help us in going us in a broad way. We'll try to have a learning from Hemendra ji, how startups can take up, and then we may witness the success stories narrated by Mr. Naresh. So I compliment all three speakers. I welcome them to this electronic platform, this digital platform, to share their stories with us so that we may have our own learnings by virtue of getting insights from them. So again, I welcome you all for this webinar, the second in the series. And let us hear our first speaker, Mr. Harish Tibrewal. Thank you.
Harish Tibrewala. Mr. Harish Tibrewala is the joint CEO of Mirum India, India's leading digital media marketing agency. Mr. Tibrewala is a Bachelor of Engineering from VJTI, Mumbai, and a Master of Science from the University of Southern California. He is a serial entrepreneur, and Mirum India is his third entrepreneurial venture. In 2014, WPP acquired a significant holding in Mirum India. Mirum is now a team of more than 250 professionals specializing in digital strategy, creative media planning, technology builds, and marketing automation. For his extensive contribution to the field of digital media, Mr. Tibrewala has been recognized as Social Media Professional of the Year by World Brand Congress, and he is also listed among the top 100 digital influencers in India as per Impact Magazine. He has also been recognized by AFAX as Newsmaker of the Year 2014.
Yep. Thank you, sir, for that very, very kind introduction. And it's my pleasure to be here.
Harish ji, please. Yeah, you can start our presentation. And I welcome and thank you. In spite of your health issues, you are here with us today. So again, thanking you and welcome.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. And the topic of my presentation is future of digital. So I will focus a larger part of my presentation talking about what is the new tools that is coming into digital, you know, that we need to be looking at. Can you go to the next slide, please? So what are the basics or fundamentals of digital? I mean, digital has been around for almost about 10 years now, you know, and the most important thing for a digital marketing activity is a great looking website. You know, a website is like our office on digital. We spend so much money making up a good office, but we don't spend similar type of amount of money in making up a website. Whether you get a person from Google or from Facebook or from video he will be coming to your website. So your website is a representation basically of your brand. So I cannot overemphasize the importance of a great looking website. Once you have a website, you need to do search engine marketing, which is how do you ensure that you come up in Google if somebody searches for you. Search engine optimization, which is the organic search in Google. You need to look at social media marketing, which is how do I be present on Facebook or on LinkedIn or Twitter. Basically, you need to be present wherever your clients are to be present. You do not need to be present on every social channel. Identify which social channel is most relevant for your business and invest in that channel. If you are in a B2B business, you may find LinkedIn very interesting. If you are in a B2C business, you may find Facebook very interesting. WhatsApp for Business is becoming very important. You know, pretty much everybody who has a cell phone in this country today uses WhatsApp. And WhatsApp now allows you an opportunity to communicate with your consumers and exchange business messages. So WhatsApp for Business is becoming very important. Besides things like Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Google, there are also a lot of portals like B2B portals or B2C portals. If you're in e-commerce, you need to look at getting your products on Amazon or Flipkart or these portals. You know, if you're in a B2B business, you need to see how can you be featured on IndiaMart. So these to me are all the basic fundamentals of digital marketing. One thing that COVID has taught us, you know, is whether our business is big or whether our business is small, and whether we are in a B2B business or a B2C business, we definitely require to be doing digital marketing and we need to have a digital delivery model. Next slide, please. So digital over a period of time has evolved from being just Google, Facebook, LinkedIn. You know, it is no longer just a communication platform. It's actually an experience platform. Next slide. And I will showcase an example. What do I mean when I say an experience platform? This first case study is about a brand called Marriott. You know, Marriott is a well-known hotel brand. And they have digitized every single consumer touch point. You know, as soon as I get down from the plane, you know, and if I made a booking at Marriott, I actually get a digital key on my phone, you know, which means that when I go to the hotel, I don't need to go to the check-in counter. I don't need to fill forms. You know, all the details are already there with the hotel. The payment is made. I have a digital key. I can just walk to my room and then show the key on front of the door and my room opens. When I'm going from the airport to the hotel, if I want to have a cup of coffee, I can place an order using my phone. As soon as I check into the hotel, you know, the room service will get a message that the customer has checked in. In 15 minutes time, a cup of coffee reaches my room. If I need to go for a client meeting and I want to book a cab, I can just call out to the Alexa voice assistant saying, book a cab. It will book a cab. It will inform me what time the cab is coming. It will also inform the concierge that a cab has been booked. So when I walk down, I can directly sit into my cab. So what is digital doing? You know, besides communication, it is creating a frictionless consumer experience where every single touch point of the consumer has been digitized. So the experience becomes very good. Next slide, please. This is another experience of, by a brand called Party City. I mean, imagine you go to a friend's birthday party. I mean, your friend's son has a birthday party and you go to the party and you find the decoration is very good. And you want to plan a similar decoration for your daughter's birthday party. You know, you just take a picture of what your friend's birthday party looks like. You come to the website called Party City. You upload the picture. Party City machine intelligence will automatically at the back end find out images of products similar to the one you saw at your friend's party and create a complete list of things for you to buy. At the click of your button, you can make a purchase. So you don't need to go around making searches. The machine is doing the search for you. Another way of creating great consumer experiences. The point I'm trying to make is digital is going away from being just Facebook and LinkedIn to actually identifying how can I make great consumer experiences. Next slide, please. I will specifically talk about three or four big technologies, next slide, which are now enabling some great consumer experiences. These are voice. You must be hearing a lot about voice. It's about AR, VR, augmented reality. It's about blockchain and it's about chatbot. Next slide, please. Voice is becoming very important. You know, already about 20% of all the search that happens on Google is via voice. You know, person doesn't go to the keyboard and type the search. He just calls out and Google is giving information. And this is expected to go to 50% in a year's time. You know, so from an internet of screen, we are going to be moving to the internet of voice. And the internet of voice has great potential in rural India. Imagine you're talking to a farmer. A farmer may not know the language to type. He may not be able to type, but he can definitely speak. And if a farmer can speak and there is the internet of voice, you can engage with that person absolutely using voice. You know, What I've listed here are some key platforms which have technologies for voice, like the Microsoft Cortana, Google Now, Alexa, Siri, Bixby. You might have heard of some of them. Siri, Alexa, Google Now are some of the biggest platforms as far as voice is concerned. Next slide, please. How does voice really work? The first application is in terms of replacement of the keyboard. You know, instead of going and typing on my laptop, I basically call out. However, the result still comes on the screen. You know, typically if I'm using a phone and I'm sitting in the car, I can just call out, hey Siri, and ask a question. And the answer will still come on my screen. So the way I'm inputting data is via keyboard. The way the answer is coming via screen. What is the implication? It immediately impacts search engine optimization. You know, when we type something, the way we type is very different compared to the way we call out the query. If I'm looking for a movie and I use my keyboard, I will say a good Bollywood movie. But if I'm using voice, I will say, hey Siri, can you tell me which theater is running a good movie around me? So the entire SEO impact gets changes. Similarly, website structure gets changed. It also becomes more conversational than more like a single way communication. So this is one application of voice, which is replacement of the keyboard. Next slide, please. The second application of voice is using devices. You know, we see these devices, Google Alexa, Google Home, and a lot of us have these devices. This is the fastest growing category nowadays in the world. And these devices are being used for things like information on weather, songs, map, etc. This device is almost becoming like a family member or like the family dog. You know, a lot of people, when they get up in the morning, they actually go and say hello to this device. So you can imagine how important these devices are becoming to the life of a consumer. Next slide, please. The challenge for a voice is, you know, if people start engaging with a voice, the brand needs to decide what is going to be my brand voice. You know, I mean, imagine you use the Alexa or the Amazon app on voice and you ask a question to Amazon. Amazon needs to be clear. Will they respond to it in a female voice? Will they use a male voice? Do you want elderly person voice, young voice, preachy voice? So a lot of implications that come up for brands the moment you get into voice. You know, there are questions like how does ad get merged, you know, when voice starts up happening? Or how do you promote a voice app? All those technologies are now coming into play. Next slide, please. The third way, of course, is that voice is becoming omnipresent. You know, very soon we are going to be seeing voice getting embedded in gadgets. You know, you can already get, for example, an air conditioner in the market where you don't need to press a button. You can just call out to the AC and say, set temperature at 32 degrees. It will do it for you, you know? So all our devices are getting voice enabled. And this entire communication is happening using internet. Very soon, a car will start talking to us. You know, when you sit in the car and you have a chat with your car, and if your car feels that you are feeling very tired, the car will recommend to you that, shall I book a massage appointment for you on your way home? You know, we have seen applications like KidsMD or Boston Hospital. I mean, KidsMD is a very interesting application where parents who have young kids and they want guidance on medical issues, instead of calling up the doctor each time, they can just call out to the app called KidsMD and they will hear the answer in the voice of their family doctor. So if they call out to KidsMD saying, my kid has diarrhea, what to do? The answer will come in the voice of the family doctor. So it gives parents the confidence that my doctor is talking to me. Next slide, please. So that was voice, which is like emerging as the fastest application now on internet. The second is augmented reality and virtual reality. You know, people tend to use these words interchangeably, but these are two different things. You know, what is augmented reality? Augmented reality is where something is actually happening in the real world. There is just more layer of drama being increased. I mean, assume I'm looking at my computer and suddenly a virtual image of a cup or a saucer appears on my screen or next to my screen. So I'm still in the real world, but there is some extra drama. Whereas virtual reality is when I put on glasses. And once I put on those glasses, I have no clue what is around me. I feel I'm a part of that immersive experience. And then we'll see how AR and VR is just making change as far as digital marketing is concerned. Next slide, please. AR/VR has been an age-old technology. Almost for 10 years, we have been talking about it. So far, mostly used for games. Now we are seeing serious business applications. And we are seeing this happening because now there are platforms available where you can quickly create applications. We are seeing 5G, which is going to become available. You know, as soon as 5G is there, this conference that we are doing today using Photograph, we can actually do using hologram. You can sit in a room and you will feel everybody else is sitting around you, all using 5G. So trust me, if COVID continues for a very long time, and I hope it doesn't, if there is 5G, the next conference will probably happen with virtual people sitting around each other, feeling like we're actually there. Next slide, please. some quick applications of AR, VR. So healthcare industry is using AR in a very big way. Industrial application industry is using AR in a very big way. Next slide, please. A lot of applications in logistics or education. In the case of education, for example, if you have a textbook with printed pictures, if you use an AR, VR image, that picture will come to life. You know, you move the AR, VR application on the picture and the entire solar system will actually start moving. So the kid can actually see everything in three dimensions. You know, safety and defense. You know, when you train soldiers, you cannot send them in a battlefield not ready. But using AR, VR, you can simulate a battlefield where they will get a feeling they are in the battlefield and they get like a real life experience. Next slide, please. Very important application in real estate and interior designing. Already in India, we see a lot of brands. If you want to buy a sofa, for example, you don't need to get the sofa actually home. You can just click a picture and position it in your house and you get a feeling as if the sofa is actually in the house. And then you can decide, does this sofa look good? Do I need to buy it or not? So amazing applications coming up with AR and VR. Next slide, please. The next is chatbots. You know, I mean, chatbots, I mean, a lot of us must have used a Facebook Messenger is a chatbot. Many times you go to a website and you can start asking questions. You know, a chatbot can be text-based, it can be voice-based chatbot. You know, examples of chatbots are WeChat, Facebook, Slack, etc., etc. Chatbots are like conversational messages. Next slide. There are two kinds of chatbot. One is like a rule-based chatbot, where you try to envisage what are the possible questions that can get answered, and you pre-program those kind of questions. The chatbot will be able to answer only those questions. If something beyond those questions is asked, chatbot will not answer it. Second is what you call as machine learning chatbot. You know, they will keep on learning based on the questions being answered and what is the person saying, is the answer right or wrong? And they will automatically start becoming more and more intelligent. Those are machine learning chatbots. Next slide, please. So what are some of the applications of chatbot? I mean, you want to order a pizza. You don't need to speak to somebody. You can go to a chatbot by Domino's. It will keep on asking you questions in a structured fashion. You know, which pizza, how many pizza, what topping, which address. You keep on giving it the answers. It will be able to take your order completely independent of an actual person out there. Casper is a very interesting chatbot for people who can't get sleep at night. You know, typically, if you can't get sleep at night, at 2 o'clock in the night, you don't want to call your friend to have a chat. You put on Casper, Casper will talk to you as if your friend is talking to you for the next 1 hour. Edward is a chatbot created for a hotel chain. You know, if you talk to Edward, it will work like a butler and arrange for whatever you require. So different kind of applications for chatbot across various industries. Next slide, please. What are the best practices of a chatbot? You know, if you're getting into a chatbot for the first time, I mean, don't get into the machine learning chatbot. It takes some time for the chatbot to get there. You know, go for a chatbot with close-ended kind of questions. Use visual communication. If we just keep on doing text, it becomes quite boring. So see if you can use visual communication or also try to engage with the person on a first name basis. You know, when somebody comes to a chatbot, ask him for his name. So whatever discussion you do, you can keep addressing the person by the name. Just gives a bit of a personalized feeling to that person who's using chatbot. Next slide, please. This is the fourth application, very, very interesting application, which is blockchain. You know, normally when we talk of blockchain, we think it is Bitcoin. We think it is cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency is one of the 20 applications of blockchain. And blockchain is something that will completely redefine the banking industry. You know, what is a bank? A bank is a custodian of trust. You know, when I go to a bank account and I see a number there, 1 lakh rupees on a screen, I'm confident that in my bag, there is actually 1 lakh. If I go someday and ask them to give me 1 lakh, they will convert it into cash. It is just trust, you know. Similarly, a government land record, you know, which shows ownership is trust. If the government land record shows that this flat is mine, I can be very confident is mine. So stock exchanges, stock repositories, money transfer companies, these people are actually custodians of trust, you know. If I transfer money from my account to your account, nobody from the bank comes to my house, takes a briefcase of 1 lakh rupees, goes to your house and delivers it. The bank is only transmitting digits from one place to another. But unfortunately, banks or people like money transfer companies are charging us a lot of money. You know, if you try to transfer money from USA to India using money transfer, $5,000, they'll probably charge you $50 fee. You know, actually the cost of transferring money from USA to India should be same as the cost of transferring an email, which is like 1 or 2 paisa. It is finally just a bit of digits, bits which are zeros and ones that are going from one place to another. So why does Western Union get away with $49? Because of trust. They give you trust. But blockchain technology is now finding a way, different way to build that trust. Next slide, please. So all these custodians of trust, whether it's a bank or whether it's a remittance service, they charge a lot of money. The second challenge is that they are susceptible to fraud. You know, if in my bank the amount is 1 lakh rupees and somebody breaks into the server and then changes the amount, I mean, that's it. I have kind of had it, you know. Plus, all of these are usually government regulated, you know. So what is the solution? Next thing. What does blockchain technology do? Blockchain technology is a way of creating distributed ledger. Right now, how much money I have in the bank is there with one bank. If somebody goes and changes the figure and the bank can't do something about it, my money is gone. But if the same information was stored by 20 different people, all independent people who are mapping the same information, moment some transaction happens in my account, it reflects in 20 different places, you know, then these places become like a block of information is there. And if somebody tries to alter the block at one place, 19 other places will still have the correct information. So for somebody to be able to fraud me, he has to be able to go and change the information at 11 places, which is going to be very, very difficult. So it gives me a large amount of security. Also, the people who are keeping this information are basically data miners. You know, they're not like banks. They're basically custodians of data who keep the data truthful. So the cost of maintaining the data is very, very easy and cheap, you know, which is why blockchain becomes very, very important. Next slide, please. That is why we are seeing, you know, on one hand, government says blockchain is banned in India, but all banks at the back end are trying to learn this technology because they know that blockchain is here to come and stay, you know. So all kinds of, next slide, please. So all kinds of advantages blockchain gives us, you know, so it protects your money, it protects your data, it can protect intellectual property. Suppose I have created a music video and I want to charge somebody 1 rupee for listening to the video. I can put on a blockchain. As soon as somebody gives me 1 rupee, he will get the music video. He can listen to it for 24 hours. Very easy way of protecting IP. You know, we are already seeing business happen at a global scale. If goods are getting shipped, mangoes are getting shipped from Brazil to USA, the entire transfer happens using blockchain. You know, using blockchain, a letter of credit is opened. Using blockchain, the documents of shipment are uploaded. You are completely out of the banking channel. No cost for banking channel. It is just blockchain. It's a secure way of transferring information. Information can be money. Information can be data. So it kind of brings an end to government monopolies. Next slide, please. This is a case study. I will specifically want to talk to you about some work we did for Kentucky Fried Chicken using marketing automation. Next slide, please. So Kentucky Fried Chicken has been our client for a number of years. And what we found is that they have a lot of customer data. You know, each time you go to KFC and you order some chicken, they will ask you for your phone number and they start collecting this data. And then they go back and map it in a database to say that against this phone number, you know, over the last 3-4 years, so many orders were received. And this is the kind of product that the person bought, you know. Last IPL, KFC wanted us to run a campaign to promote Kentucky Fried Chicken to their consumers. So what we did is that, you know, we identified using phone numbers, the location of each consumer. So who are the people in Bombay? Who are the people in Chennai? Who are the people in Delhi? We created different databases. Then on the day of the IPL match, let us say the day when Mumbai is going to be playing, let us say Delhi. On that day, people from Bombay in the database and people from Delhi in the database start getting message from KFC. If the match is starting at 4 o'clock, they will get the first message at 4 o'clock, which will say, you know, cheer for your team and go and order Kentucky Fried Chicken using our online portal. And as the match keeps on progressing, depending on who's winning or losing, the message also starts changing over a period of time. We also found a way to personalize the message. So if somebody is in Chennai, they're able to actually send a message in Telugu. You know, people respond better to local language. If somebody is in Bengal, they're able to send a message in Bengali. If somebody is in Maharashtra, we can send in the local language. So using this database segmentation, as well as personalized communication, we were able to drive huge revenues for Kentucky Fried Chicken. As you can see in this, they got like a 64% uplift in ROI because of this one single campaign. The idea of this case study is to demonstrate that whatever business we are in, you know, we can use digital to actually generate business and brand value for us. And I think these are the thoughts that I wanted to share. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to take these questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Harishji, for enlightening us on the issues of digitalization and for the poultry fraternity to adopt these digitalization techniques. But let me ask you quickly, how much these are applicable in the rural background? Because how digitalization is relevant to rural areas?
No, that's a very good question. You know, everybody today in rural India, when we talk of rural, we talk of farmers or people living there, everybody has access to a smartphone. And on the smartphone, everybody is today using Facebook and WhatsApp. These become two great channels to reach out to people in rural India. You know? There are areas where television may not reach, but digital marketing reaches those areas. You know, we have done work for tractor brands where they're trying to talk to farmers. We have done work for the insurance company that sells insurance policies to farmers, all rural background. So I think digital marketing is very, very relevant as far as rural India is concerned.
Okay. And tell me, because you have told much about the blockchains, can it be used for traceability in poultry farms?
Absolutely. A blockchain is a mechanism of keeping track of flow of data. Okay, the data can be an airway bill, it can be a shipping bill, it can be a barcode. I mean, say for example, all these vaccines that are coming all across the country, right? How can you be sure that every vaccine is genuine and the barcode is correct? Using blockchain, you can keep a track. If the entire vaccine barcode data is there in blockchain, using a simple app, you can verify whether the vaccine being given to me was actually manufactured or is it spurious. Blockchain is a way of having trusted data available to us at a very low cost. Think of it in that fashion. Then decide what is your supply chain, make it happen via blockchain, you'll have a complete trusted layer end to end.
First, two interesting things you told, AR and VR, and its uses in creating an awareness, particularly for eggs and chicken as a great source of protein, or perhaps we have used it. How do you find the Corona-19 has forced us to switch over towards digitalization, or it's a choice or preference for us?
So you know, that's a good question. You know, I mean, I've been in this industry for the last 10 years and I have to go around selling and marketing digital. I mean, last 1.5 years, I have done no marketing at all, you know. Before that, when I went to somebody, they would ask me, do I need digital? Mereko to nahi chahiye, mera to sara supply chain hai, main to janta hu kis kis ko bechna hai. Point is, when you are in a situation where you cannot move out of your house, the only way is digital communication. I mean, how are you doing this event? Digital communication. So the choice whether digital we require or not is not there. You require digital. You require digital for marketing. You require digital to connect to your customer. You require digital for your supply chain. So I think the fact that we all need to adopt digital is absolutely done. There is no question about it anymore.
Okay, thank you so much. And how this digitalization helps in our poultry production and its extension in our country?
Right.
This is applied aspect. Digital marketing.
That's a very, very good question. You know, I mean, if the idea is that how do I promote consumption of eggs or consumption of chicken in the country to a larger base, can digital really help me? I mean, my thoughts would be as follows. You know, one is that at an association level, the job is to basically find out how to expand my market. There are a certain number of people who consume the products. How can I reach out to more? And my thought is that we should segregate the marketing strategy for egg and segregate for chicken. You know, a lot of people who don't eat eggs will be comfortable eating eggs. But a lot of people who may not consume chicken may not feel comfortable consuming chicken. So I would go with two separate campaigns, then mix it up. The second thought I would do is to use influencer engagement. You know, and when I say influencer on digital, I'm not talking of a Shah Rukh Khan or a Sachin Tendulkar. I'm talking of nutritionists. I'm talking of doctors. I'm talking of fellow home physicians. If we enroll them into our program and we get them to talk about the benefits of egg or the benefits of chicken, then consumers start believing on those kind of things. You know, the third is in terms of content creation. If somebody goes to Google or to Facebook and types content that what are the myths on egg? Why should I have egg? What is the benefit? Tons of content must show up. You know, so really good content marketing, good influencer engagement is the way that we should be leveraging digital at an association level to reach out and create more consumers. And this has to be a sustained campaign. You can't do it for 2 weeks and say it is over. It has to be like a year-long program. Just about 4 months back, we made a presentation to the Coffee Board of India. Their problem statement was, India is a tea-drinking country. How do you encourage people to drink coffee? You know, and we have to give them thoughts and ideas. How do you encourage people to drink coffee, create that authentic conversation, and reach to people and run the program for a year? So I definitely feel that digital can contribute in a big way to creating the promotion of eggs and chicken consumption in the country.
Thank you so much. We have a lot of questions, but I know that you are in the occupied and we have to leave. Thank you so much. Thank you, Harish.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving the opportunity. Thank you.
Now I'll invite the next speaker, Mr. Hemendra Mathur.
Good evening to all the participants.
Hemendra Mathur. Mr. Hemendra Mathur is currently a venture partner at Bharat Innovation Fund as well as co-founder at ThinkAg, a platform for accelerating the adoption of innovation in agriculture. He also worked as chairman task force on agri startups at FICCI. Mr. Mathur completed his BE in agricultural engineering from College of Technology and Engineering, Udaipur, and postgraduate diploma in management from Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. Mr. Mathur has over 24 years of experience in venture capital, private equity, management consulting, and investment banking in India, South Asia, Europe, and the USA. He is closely connected to the food, agribusiness, retail, and consumer goods industry. He has also been involved in making policy framework, including food processing policy for India, sponsored by Ministry of Food Processing Industries, and plan for National Horticulture Mission for Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India.
That was a nice welcome. So first of all, many thanks to all the members of Poultry India, Dr. Shukla, Anilji, I also see Suresh on the call, Mr. Yadav, Vijay, and of course I don't know many of them, but a big thank you to all of you for giving this opportunity to come and talk about this very important topic of digitalization in poultry industry. So just give me a second, I'll share my presentation. Can you enable screen sharing?
Chetan?
Yeah, just a minute, sir, we are doing it.
Okay.
Yes, you can share now.
Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So what I'm going to talk today in for next 20-25 minutes, first of all, on the Indian agri-tech ecosystem, what's the current status and what are the problems which Indian agri-tech and poultry tech is solving. Of course, agri-tech is much older than poultry tech. And I was actually a little confused, should I present only poultry tech or agri-tech? But I think there are a lot of learnings from agri-tech, so I thought I'll include that. Then what are the opportunities that we see on the digitizing poultry value chains in India? And I'm sure there are a lot of entrepreneurs on the call, there are a lot of people from the industry. I also want to talk about some of the key success factors from my learnings from the startups who are developing very interesting solutions in the food and agricultural area. And last but not the least, what is the role that industry can play in promoting these innovations for the benefit of the whole poultry sector. So going to my next slide, what are we trying to solve through this new age innovation in agriculture and poultry? I would say challenges across the value chain, right from pre-production to production to post-production. All of you will know that the whole supply chain in India, the whole food supply chain is complex, is complicated. Between farmer and the consumer, there are about anywhere between 6 to 10 intermediaries, right? So if there are a lot of challenges, the data is not accurate, data is not available in a timely manner. And if you look at the pre-production side, you know, we are actually getting into a situation where our soil health is deteriorating. We are under water stress. 80% of the water that is consumed in India goes into agriculture, and that is going down, right? And we are also seeing a lot of challenges on the from the climate perspective, which is actually challenging the productivity of crops and the sustainability of agriculture in longer run. As far as poultry is concerned, you know, like agriculture, it is fragmented, typically controlled by a lot of backyard poultry farmers. And we see challenges there also in flock management, in farm management. We see a lot of cages which are broken and damaged. We see challenges around managing the litter. So I think, you know, big agriculture, big poultry, the whole supply chain needs to revamp itself to cater to the emerging demand. Another challenge that we see is on the labor, I think, which is also true for poultry. You know, that labor is becoming expensive and in some cases it is not available when it is needed. So we need more degree of mechanization in our farms. On the post-harvest side, the challenges around storage, around transportation, we waste about 1/3 of the food that we produce, which is a significant amount of wastage for a country like India, where almost 20% of the population is malnourished, right? And that's true for poultry again. You know, we have very limited value addition at the farm level. I think that's a big opportunity in waiting. You know, how do we build those innovative business models? How do we empower our farmers to add more value to increase their income? I think government has a very ambitious target of doubling farmer income. In my opinion, it is not going to come by increasing productivity or yield, but by empowering farmers to add value, become participant in the value chain, and instead of selling commodities, sell products. I think that's where we'll see a lot of transformation. Another challenge for farmers is access to good quality inputs. If you look at agriculture supply chain, a significant part of the agrochemicals which are sold are adulterated. A lot of seeds are spurious. Look, you know, from a farmer perspective, you know, they feel a lot of distress because of these bulk practices. Likewise, you know, of course, the poultry industry is very well integrated from feed to retail. But, you know, for a small older farmer who wants to run a poultry farm, how do we enable access to good quality inputs like feed, the equipment which are needed to manage a poultry farm? So I think that is another challenge. Credit, I think this is one big area which needs huge transformation. The government of India has set up a target of almost 16.5 lakh crore as priority sector lending to agriculture and elite sector, including dairy, poultry, fisheries. But you'll be surprised that only 30% of farmers, so out of 15 crore odd farmers, only about 5 to 6 crore farmers have access to institutional credit. All other farmers, mostly small and marginal, have to borrow money from local sources, informal sources, the cost of capital. Yes?
Yeah. Yes, yes, I'm there.
Sorry. Yeah, so I was talking about the cost of capital for the smallholder farmers who don't have access to institutional credit. It is almost 2 to 5% per month, which is, you know, exorbitantly high. So I think that is another area which needs transformation. Then, of course, on that, you know, if you look at the access of data that I was telling, data about hyperlocal weather, about the soil conditions, about the farm management, you know, that data is missing. So unless we start digitizing the supply chain, data will not be available. And if you want to promote institutional credit, if you want to promote, you know, farmers' access to good data, good advisory, extension services, the core is digitization. As we start digitizing the supply chain, the whole challenge of availability of timely, accurate data on the basis of which the farmer and the value chain members can make a decision, you know, if that data is available, it solves a lot of problems. Fortunately, if you look at last 5 years, a lot has changed. Of course, a lot has to change, but a lot has changed The whole agri-tech ecosystem, I would say, is about 10 years old. Between 2010 and 2015, we saw a few dozen agri-tech startups who tried to build some technology solution for agriculture. I would say initial journey was very difficult. You know, everyone questioned who will adopt, who will pay, and there were more questions than answers. But between 2015 and 2020, we saw that is changing. We saw entry of some very high quality entrepreneurs into the sector. Interestingly, many of them came without any agricultural background. They came from tech companies, essentially, like Cisco, like GE, like Honeywell, Infosys, TCS, some returning from Silicon Valley. So we saw a very interesting set of entrepreneurs who said, look, this is a very important sector. And like other sectors are changing, you know, consumer e-commerce is changing, education is changing, agriculture has to change. And they brought some very interesting solutions, which picked, you know, because of which a lot of momentum got picked. And as we speak today, there are more than 1,000 agri-tech startups in the country. And I'm very sure in the next 10 years, which I call the decade of agri-tech, poultry-tech, we are going to see this number going from 1,000 to 10,000 startups. And I'm very confident we'll get there. In terms of the money which has come into the sector as venture capital or seed money, whatever you want to call it, over the last 10 years, about $1 billion, something like 6,000 to 7,000 crores. In next 10 years, this number could be as much as $10 billion, which is very good news because a lot of these innovations need capital to scale faster and reach out to farmers. We did a study as part of ThinkCare, one of the platforms that I founded. And we found that right now, only 10% of the farmers have adopted any of these new age solutions. So, of course, it's a small number as percentage of the universe, but nonetheless, we are at the start of a journey. And I'm very sure in next 3 to 5 years, we are going to see a lot of digital adoption. I think this was the question asked in the previous session also, will farmer adopt digital solution? And my experience, mostly coming from my travel to villages, that Indian agriculture is much more digital than most of us think. In my portfolio alone, we are seeing a huge spike in the, for example, UPI payments, which farmers are making. Who could have thought that farmer will use UPI to make payments? I think that has started to happen. The farmers are using YouTube for selling their second-hand tractors. I think that's a huge market. Harishi talked about Facebook and WhatsApp. I would add YouTube to that. That YouTube is emerging as a huge medium for selling old tractors and equipment, and it is picking up very fast. So I think this question, of course, things have to change, and I'm very sure as penetration of broadband picks up, as 4G penetration also goes up, and then of course we will have 5G in some time. And there's no question that a lot of the solutions which probably farmers are not able to access today will become accessible. Government has a target of taking broadband to all 600,000 villages. I think that's a game changer. You know, those are the digital highways that we need in India, not just the physical highways that government is building. But I think digital highways are also critical to empower our farmers and, you know, to kickstart a rural economy big time. If you look at Indian startup, and I'll put some names here, I think very interestingly, a lot of startups which are started in India very young, 3-year, 5-year kind of time frame, but they are already global. For example, Cropin, I've given one example there. They've developed a dashboard for a remote crop for monitoring. They are present in 50 countries already. So the solution that we're developing in India is essentially for the globe. Because as you would know, 85% of farmers are smallholder farmers with less than 2 hectares of land. Across the world, there are 500 million such smallholder farmers, right? So whatever solution that you're developing in India, I'm very sure those are applicable in South Asia, Southeast Asia, Africa, China, and many emerging markets. So I think we have the same opportunity in agri-tech. The opportunity that we had in IT industry in 1980s and 90s, and we are all seeing the benefits. You know, for the last 30, 40 years, the whole IT industry has taken Indian talent to the globe. I'm sure agri-tech will also do the same in the next 5 to 10 years. Poultry, of course, you know, there are fewer startups, in the context of the size of the market, it's almost a 1 lakh crore industry. I would expect this should have at least 50 to 100 startups. I would say right now there are about maybe a dozen startups, maybe two dozen startups, you know. So I think definitely we need to promote more poultry startups. We have some likes of Eggos, Poultry Mall, Elmo, which are doing a good job, but we need many more of them. And even in dairy, we have seen likes of Stalex, Animal, Primansi, that's also picking up. Or a change in fishery and aqua. Again, we have seen some very interesting startups. So there is an opportunity to promote more startups in the sector, and that cannot happen without the participation of the industry. And that's the next point that I want to make. You know, the corporate sector, the industry sector, SMEs, as well as the large corporate, all of them have been watching this startup space with a lot of enthusiasm, but the partnership level was not there. I think that is maturing now. A lot of good corporates, and we have Suresh on the call. He's working with us on a few of those initiatives. So Srinivasa Hatchery, Godrej, and even companies in the agri and the food sector like some Marico, Mahindra, ITC, UPL. We are seeing more and more of them now have a startup engagement policy. They are trying to figure out how they can work with them, how this can be mutually beneficial. A lot of these corporates also realize that all the innovations are not going to come from within the company. It has to come from outside. And that's where we are seeing a very, very interesting partnerships which are developing now. And it is not a conventional customer vendor relationship. You need to do a lot of handholding, a lot of mentoring of startup. So it takes some time. It needs a very different mindset to build such partnerships. But I would say it is changing for good. In the US, in fact, if you look at in the US, most of the startups who got certain level of funding, the financial investors exited by selling to strategic investors. For example, John Deere bought a company called Blue River, which was into computer vision, almost for $300 million. Monsanto bought Climate Corp for almost $1 billion. DuPont bought Granular, again, a farm data management company. So I think we are already seeing that momentum in other parts of the world. I'm sure in India also, we are going to see a lot of interesting mergers and acquisitions happening where the large corporates will probably acquire some of these startups. Last but not the least, government policy. I think government, I can tell you, I work a lot being part of the FICCI with various ministries at the central government as well as with many state governments. There's a clear recognition for startup agri-tech. And government is saying, look, this is very important pillar of growth for the sector. The even Prime Minister in last Mann Ki Baat said that agriculture has to be modernized. And government is also putting a lot of emphasis. So I think that is good to know. A lot of states like Karnataka, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, many of them have, you know, gone on record saying that we want to develop policy to facilitate new age innovations in the agriculture and elite sector. So I think that's a very good news. Now it's coming to the topic of digitization of poultry supply chain. So divided into two parts, upstream and downstream. Upstream is essentially the feed part and the production part. And what kind of applications are we seeing there? So I think first and foremost, as I mentioned previously also, a lot of farmers struggle to get the right input at the right price at the right time. And it's very critical in this sector. The timing is very critical. I think that is the role some of the startups, which I've listed on this slide, like AgroStar, Dehat, BigHeart, Gramophone, Unnati. I think what they're doing is developing these platforms for selling inputs directly to the farmer. I think a lot of the inputs are seeds, fertilizers, and agrochemicals. But I think more and more, they are looking at nutrition, cattle nutrition, poultry feed, supplements, and equipments. So I think that's a great platform to onboard if you want to sell some of these equipments or poultry feed products or animal healthcare products directly to the farmer. And what these platforms do, it's not vanilla selling. They typically collect a lot of data from the farmer. You know, like in case of agricultural products, they collect data about soil health, crop health, hyperlocal weather parameters. and then they prescribe. So it's very prescriptive selling. So typically farmer ends up saving some money, the productivity levels are higher, the efficiency levels are higher. So I will request to all the members who are listening to this webinar, look at these alternate channels which are developing direct access to the farmers. And it's a combination of digital and physical. I won't say everything is like Amazon or a Flipkart. No, we haven't reached that ecosystem maturity. It will probably get there in some years. But right now, it's a combination of physical and digital. A lot of these platforms also use call center to address farmer queries. A lot of content is being created. I think one of the big successes that I'm seeing in this model, and I think Harishi also intended that, is a combination of vernacular, video and voice. I think this is a very important combination if you want to sell anything to farmers. And a lot of these startups are developing that content in partnership with universities, in partnership with other vendors of feed and input products, and using those that content to sell products and services. Next is access to financing. As I mentioned earlier, also, it's an extremely important area if you have to empower a farmer, if you have to reduce the cost of capital in agriculture, which is prohibitively high in the pre-harvest, in the post-harvest, and also in ancillary industries, including dairy, poultry, and fisheries. We need to enable access of institutional credit as well as insurance products to farmers. If you go to any bank, they say, look, we are happy to lend. We have a target by the government to lend to these farmers, but the cost of transaction, the cost of access is too high. And we are talking to one of the largest banks in the country. They are asking us how some of these startups can help us in making it more efficient for us. So we are doing a lot of work in this area. What we are trying to figure out, and a lot of startups are working in this space, the entire loan process, right from farmer onboarding to KYC, to credit scoring, to risk assessment, risk mitigation, all the way to loan recovery. I think all these components of a loan cycle are getting digitized. Of course, startup ecosystem is at early stage, so I won't say one startup is able to do everything. But if you bring multiple startups, they have a very strong solution which can efficiently onboard farmers, which can tell this farmer is credit worthy or not, if he's credit worthy, what is his credit score, similar to what we have in the, you know, CIBIL scores and less other stuff. Then there are startups which are into satellite imagery. They're saying, look, they're saying to bankers, you need not go all the way to farm to figure out the health of your assets. We'll give you a dashboard, and by the click of the button, you can know which farm, what is the status of the crop, how much it has grown, are there any red flags, are there any areas which are getting flooded, are there any areas which are affected by drought. So, you know, that kind of information at scale is available to bankers sitting in their branches. And of course, the last but not least, on the loan recovery, we are seeing some interesting models emerging there. And of course, I listed some of the names here who are doing some fantastic work, like Samunati, Jai Kisan, Farmart, and Vichar. The third component is around data and advisory for farmers. And there's a huge application of machine learning here. And I would say, of course, there are a lot of applications in agriculture. What I've highlighted on this slide is applications in layer farms, boiler farms. This is essentially capturing data which is critical for any poultry farmer. Data around weather data, like temperature, humidity, ammonia emission, water quality, carbon dioxide emission, data logs. So I think a lot of this data needs to be captured. And how startups are doing it, I think there are multiple hardware devices, essentially combination of sensors and IoT devices, which are put into the farm. That data comes to a server, and these startups have developed the proprietary algorithms which convert data into actionable insights. So I think that is the kind of work which is happening, and it is essentially helping poultry farmers to manage their farm more efficiently. It can help in crop management, it can help in disease management. In fact, there's a lot of application of image processing now, where you capture disease, you capture images of the birds, and you map it. You run your algorithm, and you can say whether the bird is sick or not. And it can in some cases also detect diseases. You know, so without being and physically inspecting the world with these devices, you can capture the images and you can figure out, you know, whether the bird is sick, what kind of disease and stuff like that, and accordingly take action. So there's a huge application of image processing. These images can be captured in some cases through a smartphone, but there are some high resolution optical cameras, and there are applications of computer vision, which would help you get these images. And of course, you know, that can help a lot of the farmers as well as the poultry companies in managing a large number of farms and large farms with large number of birds much more efficiently without the need of physical manpower in the farm itself. And again, I listed some startups here. I'm sure some of you must have known them or heard them. PoultryMon, Algol, Poultrix, Eggos, Poultrek. There are a lot of startups, in fact, in other geographies also who are looking at Indian market. There are quite a few in Israel, like Poultrix, for example, some in Netherlands, some in UK. Of course, most of them are working in their home countries, but I'm sure as a solution scale, I won't be surprised when startups from other countries in the poultry sector will look at Indian market as well. On the downstream side, which is essentially the distribution and the branding side, again, opportunities in first of all in market linkages for both egg and meat, and we are seeing platforms like Leashers, like Fresh to Home, Tendercuts, Eggos, who are developing this chain, building, and this is essentially demand-driven tech-enabled supply chain where you build models where you can capture the demand and you use multiple elements of technology. You know. For example, how do you make payments to the farmer? How do you control inventory? How do you do quality control? How do you do quality assaying? So these are multiple elements of technologies that come together and they build a tech stack. But the whole idea is to do a farm to fork kind of supply chains. And frankly, Leashers and Fresh to Home are two such examples which have scaled quite a bit. In fact, there's a news today said that Leashers is raising something like $225 million at a valuation of $800 million. So I'm very confident in the whole agri-tech, the food tech, poultry tech, whatever tech related to agriculture and elite sector. The unicorns of a startup which have $1 billion valuation. It could be Leashers or Fresh to Home, so that clearly shows the potential the whole animal protein sector has. And there's a clearly a demand for such more such models. We are already seeing a couple of models. We are also seeing some models in equine fisheries like Captain Fresh, like Numerate, Zalongi, who are developing a similar model with focus on fisheries. So I think these are the models which one can look at. And in COVID times, we have seen that the direct consumer models have already picked up a consumer which were very sort of skeptical of buying online. I think that true shift has happened. The digital behavior of consumer has changed. And fortunately, supply chain is also gearing up with all these technology tools to cater to the demand which is coming from the digital media. So I think that should be one of the focus area for the entire industry, how to look at alternate channels to reach out to the end consumer. I think Dr. Shukla asked to Harish on the potential for traceability applications of some of these digital technologies in this sector. Huge application, and I'm so happy that Harish just spoke before me, so I need not explain them. Blockchains and multiple traceability tools, right from barcode to scanners. And the whole idea is to capture from where the product is coming, what are the intermediate sort of steps or routes which it has taken to reach out to the customer, and capture also information on the quality parameters. So it's not just traceability, I would say it's a combination of traceability and food safety. which is captured by some of these startups who are focused on traceability. And that information is given to the consumer so that consumer feel confident that the product that he's buying is the right product. And I think these solutions are extremely important. Of course, a lot of these solutions, I would say, are must for building export link supply chain, because a lot of Indian exports across food categories get rejected because the traceability information is not there. I think the domestic customer is also becoming more and more aware, and we see a lot of consumers, even in Indian market, demanding this information. So this could be one big differentiator. If you're in air or if you're in meat, if you can say confidently that this product which is being sold is safe to consume, and if you can give the entire history of the product right from farm to the consumer, they, I'm sure at least some section of the consuming population would pay a premium for it. And there are again multiple startups that put down here. None of them are poultry specific, but have the capability to serve the poultry industry. Last but not the least, it's a contentious trend, but we should acknowledge it. Alternative proteins, I think it is picking up. There are startups who are working on proteins from plants. There are startups who are looking at cultured or cultivated meat, as we call it, and also looking at meat substitutes. All I want to say, this is a very early days in India, but my thesis is that the meat substitute market in India is still very small. Our per capita consumption of most of the meat products is still very low. I think poultry about 4 kgs, in eggs, it's about, I think, 80 eggs per year. So I don't see India to be a meat substitute market. But having said that, we are a protein deficient country. So there's a possibility that we can extract protein from more sources, particularly plant proteins. And it can be positioned as an alternate protein rather than it being positioned as a meat substitute, which we see more in the US, in Europe, and also in Singapore. You know, the brands like Impossible Foods, brands like Perfect Day, there are milk substitutes, there are meat substitutes, there are egg substitutes. So I won't say that that it is going to be a big trend, at least in India in the near future. But we should be, as an industry, we should acknowledge the trend that when someone like Tyson Foods, who's a large poultry player, is investing in some of these models, you know, you start wondering what's happening. And there are reports which also say that it could be $100 billion industry. But having said that, I think India, we still have a lot of room for growth for meat and egg. Our per capita numbers are very, very low. So it could become a category, but my guess is at least in near to medium term, let's say 3 to 5 years or 3 to 10 years, it will remain a niche category as far as alternative protein based meat products are concerned. I'll quickly run through remaining slides. I think I've taken more time in the first section. What are the key success factors? So I think this is essentially from my learnings working with startup directly. I think one thing which I really like about them, and I think all of us have a lot to learn from them, and since I invest across sectors, I think one thing which I find very unique in agriculture and livestock sector is that a lot of startups have built frugal models. They don't believe in promoting these models at the cost of economics. You know, if you look at models in the urban India, a lot of it is driven by promotions, discounts. But in rural centers,
can we be quick?
Yeah, give me. Plant more money, so that's good. And there's a lot of discipline among these startups in terms of how to use capital for scale. Unit economics is key, and we are seeing a lot of these startups, even if they are not able to raise next round of money, they don't die. The mortality rate of these startups is still under, I would say, 10 to 15%, which is very good if you compare with startups in the other sector. I think one area which is a struggle is team composition. A lot of these startups have founders which come from tech background. The knowledge about domains, be it agriculture or poultry, I think is low. So I think we need to build talent if you want to scale these models further, bring the right tech knowledge, bring the right domain knowledge together, and you know, that will create a lot of value. Another key factor, I think, where industry has a role to play is build an enabling ecosystem. We are seeing a lot of interesting models around incubation. I have put good incubators which are doing interesting work in this area. CIS, who at IIM Ahmedabad, AIIBX now, Wilpro, Usha Prashi, Indigram, Equiset. I think they have done a fantastic job nurturing these startups at a very, very early stage. Government has run a lot of programs to support these startups and even given seed funding. Corporate Connect, I've already mentioned, which is picking up. I think one area which is lacking is village level ecosystem, because a lot of the solutions are developed in cities like Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, Delhi. How do they bring these solutions to villages? And that's where we need partnership with the local ecosystem, which is FPOs, village level entrepreneurs, local NGOs, or the local SMEs or industry which is working in that area. I think that is probably one missing link. I hope, that that will change for good. I just put down the logos of the key incubators in this space. You can, of course, do a research on them. They've done a pretty good job in building the startup ecosystem. Funding, I've already spoken, is picked up, is changing for good. If you have a good idea, good model, good team, you'll raise money. Last slide from my side, and just a piece of advice to all the members who are attending this call. How can you support this startup ecosystem? So first and foremost, I think we need many more startups, many more innovators in the poultry sector, and you can support mentoring by creating sandbox for digital innovation, giving them a platform to try out their innovations. Some innovation will work, some will not work. So it's not, the success rate is never 100%. So you have to be prepared with it. You have to be a little patient with it. You can do seed funding. Government is already doing it, but I think industry can also take a leap and do some bit of seed funding for technical validation or go-to-market strategies. Enable partnerships with FPOs, with MSMEs, with feed companies, with processing companies. It's infrastructural support. I think a lot of startups struggle to get to the government bodies. So can we facilitate with our network, you know, if there are any policy level interventions that are required. And since a lot of these applications are digital, you need a lot of data sets in training your data. In any AI model, in any machine learning model, to achieve 100% or 99% accuracy, you need millions of data points. And, you know, they don't have data points. I think startups struggle. They spend 80% of their time collecting data, which is not their core strength. So can we enable access of data? Because as an industry, we have a lot of data. So that they can build algorithms and machine learning models on it. So yeah, I would probably end here and thank you, all of you, for giving this wonderful opportunity. You know, we are short of time. I'll stop here. But if you have any questions, any suggestions, if you want any connect with any startup in any particular field, of course, there are many in poultry, but in other fields also in agri-tech or food tech, I'm happy to facilitate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, MNG, for enlightening us on the issues of startups and ecosystem in poultry tech. Thank you so much. And we do hope that a lot of new entrepreneurs, they are likely to come up with new startups. We our industry will incubate their ideas and let us see how it will work. We do have a lot of questions, but I think in the last, we'll try to discuss it as we are in short of time. So I invite our next speaker, very vibrant one, and he is a real person who has adopted the technology for sustainable production of animal production. So initially, we had some ideas from Harish Tibrewalaji, how digital world will work for poultry. Then we had some startup ecosystem from Hemendraji, and now it's a time, a person who has really translated these two things into a venture. Let us listen to Mr. Narendra.
Good evening. Sir, are you able to hear me?
Yes, Narendra.
Narendra Pasuparthi. Mr. Narendra Pasuparthi has more than 16 years of experience in handling various responsibilities and roles in the poultry industry. He is founder and currently the Chief Executive Officer at Nandu's Foods Private Limited. It is a leading egg and chicken provider in Bangalore. While Nandu's initially entered the industry with chicken farming, now they have ventured into other meat, fresh, semi-cooked
and fully cooked delicious meals. Nandu's products are sold at their exclusive stores all over Bangalore city. Mr. Pasuparthi also worked as the director Karnataka and UAE operations at Nanda Group Bangalore, where he was in charge of the group's poultry operations in Karnataka, India and UAE.
Mr. Narendra, please.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you very much for the wonderful introduction. Should I present, share my screen?
Yes, sir, you can do it.
Will you be sharing the presentation?
So whatever you are comfortable with, if you want, you can share your screen.
I can do it. Not at all. Yeah, are you able to see this?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, fantastic. So, I think we heard, how technology influences our businesses. Just a second, let me throw up this. From Mr. Tibrewala, and then Mr. Mathur about the entire ecosystem, about the agri-tech startups and all that. It's a tall order for me to be presenting after these stalwarts. In fact, we have taken some of these, the knowledge that they have shared and implemented this at Nandu's. So my talk today is about, topic is about, I want to talk about how to digitize a legacy business. So what is legacy? Okay. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Okay. How about now?
Okay? Can you make it full screen, Naren?
Yeah, this is full screen, sir.
Oh, okay.
Are you able to see the full screen?
No, we are able to see the screen. Yes. Okay.
Okay. How about now? Is this better?
No, it's same.
Do you want to try share it from your side, sir?
Okay, so we'll do that. Yeah. You can just stop there.
Okay, fantastic. So what is legacy business for us? Nanda Group is our legacy business. My father, Mr. Nanda Kumar, is the first gen entrepreneur who started the poultry business back in the early 60s. And we played very pivotal role in shaping the Indian poultry. Had the privilege to participate in some key moments in the history of the industry. 50 years of experience as a poultry breeding company, as a feed manufacturing company, as a integration farming company, and as a chick producer. So that's the legacy. Next, please. So Nandu's is our latest initiative started by my brother, Mr. Naveen, and myself in 2016. The idea was we are a full stack player. We own the feed mill, breeding farm, hatcheries. We produce chicks. We sell chicks to farmers. Then we have integration farming. And that's where the entire supply chain ended up until 2016. And in 2018, we decided that we ought to be producing great quality chicken and taking it directly to our end consumers. That's when we started Nandu's. And today Nandu's is India's largest hyper-local and omni-channel farm-to-fork meat retail brand. And we are growing rapidly at scale. We have been doubling our revenues every year since 2016. Next. So, like I said, we are a full-stack player. beyond the feed mill, breeding farm, hatchery, processing, then the broiler farms with we integrate with 100 farmers growing chicken for Nandu's, and then the processing facilities, and now with Nandu's, we are an omni-channel meat retail brand, bringing our produce directly to the end consumers. Next. So our purpose at Nandu's is to provide safe and healthy meat in a very convenient manner to consumers at affordable prices. That's our purpose. Next. And our vision going forward is to be the most loved and trusted meat brand for our consumers. Next. And what is the problem with meat? We all produce great quality meat. We all hand that over to traders. Thereafterwards, the whole supply chain is broken. The whole user experience, the consumer experience is completely broken, right? We have 100% of the market, 90% of the market is wet, 10% of it is, I would say about 8 to 9% of it is fresh chilled, and roughly between 2 to 3% online is what's the category that has come up in the last 5 years. So what is the larger problem here? Next. So, before starting Nandu's, we reached out to a lot of consumers and really wanted to understand what is their pain points. Some said, simply said, where can I find good meat? Although we had meat everywhere, meat shops everywhere, consumer is actually looking for good sources of meat. Lots of questions. I don't like going to the nearest meat stalls. It's dirty and I feel yucky. I think this weighing scale is rigged. I have this annoying feeling of being cheated. I don't like it. Lots and lots of questions from the consumers. Next. Yeah. And the housewife is she's got her own issues. The shop we buy from doesn't give me the portions I want. It just adds more to my work. She has to bring in the whole chicken, cut it at the, cut it on the kitchen counter. The meat is releasing so much water while it's cooking, it's going to spoil my dish. That's our other concern. I can see some remnants, bits and pieces, bone splinters, blood clots. There's some blood. It's absolutely the whole meat buying to meat preparation. The whole experience was not palatable to the end consumers. Next. And what is the solution? Next. So our solution was to fix this broken piece in the entire supply chain. We all produced great quality feed, awesome parents, IoT enabled hatcheries, very efficiently run integration farms. But then the birds leave our facilities, and by the time it reaches the consumer's got all of these problems. So our solution was to create an omni-channel, hyper-local meat brand. When I say meat brand, poultry is still the largest consumed meat in India. We estimate that to be about 60%. There's about 55% would be chicken. Remaining 30 to 35% is roughly fish. And then there are other meats like mutton and pork and beef and all that. So our idea was to create that ambience, a purchasing experience to the end consumer, which was palatable to them. There should be transparency, traceability. The meat buying experience has to be fantastic. So we went with the omni-channel approach where we created offline stores as well as an online delivery mechanism. So therefore at Nandu's, there are four ways to buy meats. One is you visit our store. Other one is you call an order on our 800 number. You can go on the web or you can download our app and order to the through the app, and we will deliver it under 2 hours. That's our solution to break that, to solve that broken piece in the entire supply chain. Next. So this is what we are about. We want to take the local butcher store and give it the Nandu's experience. Next. So again, it's a delightful experience where families are comfortable coming and buying. The decision maker at the home is actually bringing a child to the store and purchasing. She feels a lot more comfortable. The staff are trained in retail sense. So we have actually, you know, we have an entire retail training team that goes out to the stores and trains them on how to engage with the customer. It's a buying experience that's unparalleled and never before has it happened in India. Next. So the offline is a big market and we don't want to ignore that at all. No matter what happens, online is one of the delivery mechanisms alone. The poultry and meat is still an offline purchase. It's a ritualistic purchase. Indian consumers are still very passionate about watching what they buy and what they purchase. So offline was very important, but at Nandu's, we sweat the offline asset to leverage the e-commerce business as well. Next. So again, now coming to the most important aspect. So being a hyper-local omni-channel meat retailer means a lot of tech. So Nandu's, we are all about traceability and transparency. We want to talk to our consumers and we want to expose our entire, the supply chain and all of what we have digitized to the end consumer. Mr. Tibrewala was talking about blockchain. In fact, that is one of the technologies that we are exploring to deliver on the promise of traceability. Because all of our supply chain, from feed milling all the way to meat retailing, the entire supply chain is digitized. We have in-house web-enabled software that we have developed over the last few years, and it's hosted on AWS, and we capture all of the data in real time from all of our manufacturing facilities. So we are looking at solutions where we would be putting this data up on the blockchain so that anybody buying chicken at our outlets will scan a QR code and get the entire history of where the chicken came from, how did it grow, what feed it ate. So that is some examples on how digitization can be applied for a traditional industry like us to earn the trust of the consumer. Right. So we have not just the commercial broiler farming operations, the meat processing, food processing, packaging, the entire retail touch point. Everything is digitized. Next. And what this digitization helps, it helps us scale rapidly. So in 4 years, you know, if you took out the COVID year, we have been around for about 4 years now. You take out COVID year, we are about 3 years. In 3 years, we have successfully built 52 outlets in the city of Bangalore and scaled very efficiently, all because of tech, right? So our e-commerce engine was initially sassed out. We are building our own e-commerce engine. At a certain level, it becomes imperative that you own your code. Our e-commerce software was sassed out because we were very focused on building the core competencies around retail, the core competency in technology for retail. So the last 4 years have been about building a tech platform which enables you to operate like an omni-channel player. So there's a very huge difference in being an online player and an offline player. And when you're actually operating as an online offline player or as an omni-channel player, that tech makes it even more, plays an even more critical role, right? It has to be complex. It has to address the needs of two different ways of operating the business. One is retail, one is e-commerce. And that's what tech is all about. And when you have that tech solution in place, the business is infinitely scalable, right? So our e-commerce engine, we are building our own e-commerce engine in-house in about a month's time that will be launched, but we have been omni-channel and online present for the last 4 years. We built up enough scale and business online so that we put together a team to be able to do that. Now, when you're especially talking about the e-commerce engine, when you build out an e-commerce engine, Mr. Tibrewala was talking about search engine optimization, search engine marketing. These are extremely specific skills. For example, when you build out your e-commerce engine, you have to engineer the search engine optimization as part of building your e-commerce engine. For example, if you weave in the right code that goes into an e-commerce platform, organic search happens. your Google and your other search engines, they are looking for certain e-commerce sites and pages to be structured in a very specific way where they can start, where you can start building your, you know, what they say as organic rankings. That happens. Then you have your search engine marketing that's related to Google AdWords, Facebook advertising, Instagram, and that needs very specific skills. There is no doubt that digitization is the future. Digital marketing is the best way to get value for your money. And all of these have to become part of your DNA. There are tools out there. There are people out there. You just have to focus and bring in those resources to make it all possible. Then again, next. So like I mentioned earlier, our ERP system is completely, we have an ERP system that is completely tech enabling our supply chain. That builds into our point of sale system that we have built in-house. And that ties into our e-commerce system. And we are actually the only meat retailer in the space today who's offering a loyalty program. So we choose best of breed loyalty program from MLoyal, and we have tied that up into our in point of sale system, wherein when a customer comes in for any purchases, he's actually earning points. This only happened at Taj Hotels or, you know, Marriott Bonvoy, but that's happening in a chicken store right now. It enables us to actually profile the consumer, do targeted advertising, targeted marketing. If he doesn't come back to us, we know how to bring him back because we know everything about him. So these are some of the ways that you can create stickiness, and all of this possible only because of tech. So we are industry's first loyalty program, and that's helped us create stickiness and sort of retain our consumers beyond industry metrics, right? And then we have next piece. So we are very heavy on marketing. Roughly 50% of our business comes from online. And we are very heavily focused on Google AdWords, then Google Display Networks, where your content gets displayed on all the various internet properties, on the various media properties on the internet. Then we are big on Instagram, where we create a lot of content. Again, you have to engineer. See, retailing chicken is one thing. Retailing chicken online is another thing. When you're talking about online marketing, when you're talking about online sales, the way you think about it, it's a science. Okay, selling offline is an art. Selling online is a science. So you need to put together a team that is focused on performance marketing. When I say performance marketing, these teams are sitting there and looking at Google AdWords, our rankings on Google searches, our visibility on the Google Display Network, then our visibility on YouTube. Then we have another team that creates a lot of content, quick cook recipes. Then, you know, how to videos, a lot of content. We have an entire team that is constantly creating content for e-commerce. We have another team that works on performance marketing. So in that sense, when you look at how we have applied technology to a very traditional business, if we would not have applied this technology, then we would be a pure play offline retailer. You know, customer would come in, there's no beyond me selling chicken to him, there's no other relationships happening. Now those days are gone. There are the likes of Licious, Fresh to Home, then Nandu's and the whole bunch of meat retailers who give that delightful experience to the consumer. Now, if you are looking at a pure play meat retailer offline, you come into the store, buy the meat, pay me the money, and you're gone. That customer is not going to stick around. So technology makes that all possible. Right, it helps you build a relationship with your end consumer. It helps you upsell him. It helps you retain him as a customer. It helps you profile him. It helps you kind of send out targeted advertising to him. So these are new ways on how Nandu's adopted technology to kind of build out a business that is today. That is what Nandu's is today. So, you know, more than happy to take any questions regarding how, you know, other companies in the poultry space are looking at digitizing their businesses. With that, I hand this over to Mr. Nanil.
Thank you so much, Narendra ji. Indeed, it's a matter of pleasure to listen
Thank
to you.
Sir.
I have a lot of questions. In fact, I was going through the question box that Mr. Dhananjay, he wants to know what is the ROI, how much you have invested on the stack, what is the recovery period. So I think I can request you to answer these in their boxes because we are running short of time. So better at this point of time. It's better if you can make all the replies in their request box.
I mean, I am the son of the poultry business. Okay.
Yeah.
Very deeply rooted in poultry is my family. Very deeply rooted in poultry. But if we don't wake up as an industry and as a producer and smell the coffee, you're going to be done for. The future is about reaching the end consumer. So keeping that in mind, you know, me and my brother undertook the journey of Nandu's and we are investing for the long term. We have seen phenomenal growth. Like I said, every year we have doubled our revenues. We have put out value-added products. We are investing in the future. So, you know, where others are investing in more breeding facilities, more chick production and bird production, we have taken a slightly different route and said, you know, let's build for the consumer. And I think, you know, we are not anywhere close to ROI at the moment. I mean, profitability at the moment, but ROI will come in the future, right? We are building for the future. Today, we are at 50. We are currently raising funds. We are looking to build about 600 outlets across 7 cities and planning to be a 2000 crore company in the next 5 years. The opportunity is massive. So if I today restrict myself and said, I'm going to stick to City of Bangalore, 50 outlets, I'm good. No more. I have about 300,000, 400,000 customers who are, you know, 80% of them being repeat. I am set. As in, you know, today we stop all the marketing spends, we break even and we start making profit in about 4 months. But that's not the game. The opportunity is very large and we are going after that big opportunity.
Thank you so much.
So, in a nutshell, I would say it's an investment for the future.
Thank you
and
so much.
And the future is not 10 years. And the future is not 10 years. The future is next 5 years, 5 to 7 years.
Yeah, let us start it. Thank you very much. And indeed,
thank you, doctor.
It was a real pleasure talking to you. Thank you. Good evening, friends. Indeed, all three speakers, they have presented a nice contents to all of us. And I really thank Mr. Harish Ibrewala, Mr. Hemendra Mathur and Mr. Narendra Pasuparthi to be with us and that too in a very short notice and enlightened us. And now it's a time for felicitation. So I hand it over the platform to Mr. Harish Garware for the further activities. Mr. Harish Garware, please. And just a minute, let me communicate almost today 414 attendees joined us in this webinar and 431 watched us live on Facebook. It was around 800 attendees, those who have watched this program, they attended this program. Thank you so much. Over to Harish.
Sir, can we just run the poll before we conclude
sure,
the felicitation?
Sure.
So Chetan, you can launch the poll. Requesting everyone to please respond to the poll. We will keep it on for about a minute or so. Just three simple questions.
Good evening. In the panel, all these eminent persons are there. If they want to add something to the topic, I think we should allow them to do it.
I think all can unmute and all can switch on to their videos.
So I think, Professor, I just wanted to say one thing.
Sure.
Anybody, I remember, you know, 1992, I finished my engineering and came back and joined the business. And my father had bought two computers from Venkis. Purane jo unke khatam ho gaye to, then, you know, that's how it started. And the question then was, do we need computers? Right? Aaj sabke job mein do hai. And I didn't forget about the, because I was looking at the performance of my first computer and my iPhone today is 100 times, I think 1,000 times more powerful than actually than that first computer I had. And then computers, of course, are at a different level. So anybody who's questioning, do you need digitalization? I say you are exactly that position today. So without digitalization, I think you will be out because our growing at least will be very difficult. And I think that's all I want to say. Thank you.
Balramji, you want to add something? Sundarajan sir, you can add something. You are already in the retailing and you know, you have the store. You have to unmute yourself, Sundarajan.
Okay.
Oh, Balramji is also there.
Balramji, you want to add something?
No, Mr. Sundarajan is talking. No? Yeah.
Sir, you are on mute, sir.
I think Balramji, you talk. By the time he will be on.
Sure.
Yes.
So thank you very much. Three wonderful presentations, and I would say that they were very enriching presentations, and I strongly believe that time has come to digitalize everything. And normally what I have seen in the world is that automation and digitalization starts at the top and at the bottom. Top because it is very highly skilled and very, very rare talent areas, and the bottom because they are very, 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 I would say, highly engaged and low tech. So for example, if you see poultry farms, poultry processing plants, etc., or say even the entire meat industry in the world, automated much, much faster than many industries because people would not like to do this kind of a job. And definitely I feel the time has come that our industry has to follow suit. And I firmly believe consumer engagement definitely would require lot of digital support, but there is a huge amount of efficiency which has to be captured at the farms, at the slaughterhouses, at the hatcheries, at the feed mills also. Because we have seen that what integration brought in last 20 years is that they made the supply chain very efficient. And that is why real cost of chicken has not increased that much if you remove the minor variations on a CAGR basis, if you remove the year-to-year variations of raw material. That has come about because we have started monitoring, and whatever we started monitoring, we started improving. And I think with technology, we can do that in real-time basis. This is animal agriculture. It is a 365 days, 24/7 kind of a job. No human being can do that. That is why technology is needed. So my sense is that I see huge amount of efficiency improvement coming in supply chain in next 5 years. A lot of automation I see at different paces in different business systems, and this will continue. So that's point number one. I think dairy is very, very integrated throughout the world, and I can see that some kind of technology development is happening in dairy, particularly bigger companies are driving that. The other thing is consumer engagement. I fully agree with Naren. It has changed. Every individual, all 7 billion of us, have been spoiled by Google and Facebook, etc., by customizing the offering for that individual. And plenty of times when you are searching Google, you sometimes you feel that, how has it read my mind also? Because you just type the first name and the next surname or the next thing comes immediately. I think this is what machine learning is And I think this is what is going to drive consumer engagement in future. So this is the direction of this industry. And I'm glad that you opened up this kind of a program and session so that people start thinking in that direction. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Balramji. Sundarajanji, you can speak now.
Okay. It's all three programs are very good. Timely you started digital. Already, I think industry following a lot of digital activities. Many of the industries following, and the poultry industry also learning much faster. Future, lot of automation, corporate farming also will come, aligned with what Mr. Balaram told. Machine do better than people. These are the futures, but good initiatives. Congratulations for the Poultry India team. Thank you so much.
Mr. Anand, can you speak now? Give your views. Mr. Anand, you are there? Mr. Samir, you are there?
Just wanted to add one thought, I may. Digitization for an industry like us is a very painful process. Although I'm a software engineer, attracting good tech talent into a company or into a business like ours is a very tough calling. In fact, my CIO comes from Domino's, and I probably, I haven't asked my wife as much to marry me, compared to how much I pursued this guy to come and join me, right? But they bring in great business practices, amazing exposure to the retail segments. So it is a tough calling. Digitization is a very, very tough calling. You'll have a lot of consultants selling you stuff. You'll have the wrong hires. Finding good talent is a problem, but it is inevitable. Just as an example, we built a very open point of sale platform, custom developed it in-house. And when we started talking to Swiggy, we were able to integrate with Swiggy in under 1 week. And today in Bangalore, 27% of meat sold on Swiggy and Dunzo happens because of Nandu's. So technology is tough. It is draining, straining. It needs a lot of budget. They are expensive, most expensive hires that you could have in your company. But what they deliver is just incredible. So you just have to be patient with it. So those are my two thoughts.
Good. Thanks, Naren. Samir, you want to add something?
It was a wonderful experience listening to all the three speakers. Very enriching, I must say, especially Mr. Tibrewala, the AR, VR, and everything that he spoke about, Mr. Mathur as well as Mr. Pasuparthi. I would like to congratulate you, Mr. Pasuparthi, for all the good work that you are doing for bringing chicken to the consumers. And definitely back-end poultry was always, getting into technology. I think the front-end has also got an opportunity, especially after the pandemic, to go online and reach the consumer in a better and in a more hygienic way. So congratulations to all. Thanks to Poultry India for organizing.
Good. Thanks, Samir. Anand sir, you want to add something? Mr. KJ Anand. Anand sir, you're there?
Hello.
Yes, Anand sir.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, I can hear you. We can hear you.
I think it was wonderful today, completely different from the standard technical presentations. And I think this is the future, undoubtedly. And almost all the speakers have really a lot of experience and added value to it. And I feel overall, everybody gained by this the presentation of today. And expect the future, and we have gained and probably also gained experience. And I congratulate Poultry India team for organizing this seminar. Thank you.
Thank you, Anandji. Jagbirji, you want to add something? Jagbirji. You have to unmute yourself.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Umal, thank you very much for your nice presentation. And really, it is very knowledgeable for your team, for all this, like this Polity India team. And really, it is the future to direct contact to the consumer, our products. This is the future of the industry. And this is the one of this digitalization is a very important part of this all this segment. So thank you very much, all like Polity India team.
Good. Mr. OP, you want to add something? OP? OP Singh, you want to add something? Naren, you wanted to speak something? Naren, you wanted to say something?
No, sir. No, sir. No, 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 nothing. I'm good. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, sir.
Okay. Shuklaji, we can carry on.
Yeah, yeah. I think this was second in our series, what we started in November 2020. And in a time to come, we'll come up again with a new webinar, maybe in a less than a month time. Thank you very much, Poultry India. Thank you very much, all ESE members, those who have joined today. And now for further...
Momentos.
Yes. So now I'm handing it over for felicitation to Mr. Harish Garwara. Mr. Harish.
Yeah. We are going to hand over mementos. First, we give the memento to Mr. Harish Tebriwala. And I think we would like to do it digitally.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We'll do it.
Okay. Now, give it to Mr. Hemendra Mathur. And now present it to our Naveen.
Naren.
Sorry.
Both of them. Both of them.
It's okay, sorry. It's one and the same.
No, not same. Naren is Naren.
Naren and Naveen.
Sir, I must say, this is the most sustainable gift I've ever been given. It's very
Harish, exciting. Harish, I want you to send this memento to all the speakers.
Yes, I will do it.
Physical credentials.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, my fellow poultry associates and Knowledge Day webinar guests, this was really a wonderful day of knowledge sharing and learning. Today's subject, harnessing the power of digital application for poultry industry, was bang on. And we had excellent reasons presented by Harish Tebriwala, Hemendra Mathur, and Naveen Pasubharti, who showed us how it can be done and why it is the need of the hour. The pandemic, to a certain extent, has helped our industry improve protein awareness and healthy eating habits. Today, online or digital communication is the new mantra. Poultry industry must quickly adapt this changing scenario. Every sector of our industry, be it farming, management or marketing, should harness the power of digital application. I want to thank Poultry India's EAC and Knowledge Day committee members who continue to work relentlessly to ensure knowledge is shared, sustained, and finally implemented where possible. Most importantly, I want to thank the online delegates who have participated in this amazing event. Thank you. Please stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for joining and have a wonderful evening.
Namaskar. And stay tuned, we'll be back soon.
Yeah. Thank you.
So we will close the webinar now.
Derek, is it closed now?
We are closing it now.
You are closing it, but whatever the question and answers you got, I think they need to be replied to the people who
Have been replied. Most of those have been replied.
Okay.
Still, jo nahi hua hai, wo will take care.
Yeah. So maybe okay. You can send us the question. So, Dr. We will work out together with the speakers and reach out to.